Okay, we're now going to take the Joukowsky cylinder geometry and find another special case that makes that Joukowsky cylinder into what's called a Joukowsky airfoil. So just to review, the Joukowsky cylinder has 4 degrees of freedom. And those degrees of freedom are the radius of the circular cylinder in the zeta plane, epsilon, that's a measure of the eccentricity, and then the location of the cylinder, we call that zeta naught. That's the location of the cylinder in the zeta plane. And today we're going to use the x and y components of that, and so we'll be calling those c naught, that's the x direction or the real component, plus I times eta naught. So these are the two components. Remember, zeta is a complex number, and so here we have 1, 2, 3, 4 degrees of freedom for moving that or changing the geometry of a Joukowsky cylinder. Okay, so let's look at what some examples might look like here. So we've got this cylinder, remember, in the zeta plane, and we can choose epsilon. Epsilon is just are those singularities, the eccentricity then that gives us an ellipse in the z plane. So let's look at those singularities here for just a second. The singularities caused by epsilon, they happen at zeta equals r minus epsilon, plus and minus. Okay, so we see because r and epsilon are both real numbers that those singularities will always lie on the real axis. They don't have any imaginary components, so they'll always lie on the real axis. We also see that the location of that singularity does not change as we move the cylinder by zeta naught. Okay, as we move that around in the zeta plane, if we move the center of the cylinder up here, for example, those singularities don't move, they're independent of the location of that cylinder. Okay, so let's look at what happens if we move. Well, actually, let me just put this on the right here, just in a different color. So let's say that we move the cylinder to the left a little bit, so it would look something like this. So imagine that's still a perfect cylinder over there. Then in the z plane, what would happen? And let's put our singularities over here in the z plane. What would happen is that we would now have an ellipse that's a bit wider on the left-hand side and narrower on the right-hand side because we've moved this to the left. And this singularity got closer to this boundary here. And so it's going to make a narrower ellipse here and a wider ellipse down at this end. We can even take that one step further and move the cylinder so that one of those singularities falls right on the edge of that cylinder. And when we do that, what happens is we get a shape that looks like this. That singularity now falls on the right-hand side of that ellipse and creates what's called a cusp. And that is the trailing edge of our airfoil, of the Joukowsky airfoil. So that's the definition of a Joukowsky airfoil, is that we've moved this parent cylinder, or the cylinder in the zeta plane, over to the point that the edge of the cylinder lies on that singularity. And then in the z plane, that ends up making a singularity there in the geometry, or a sharp angle there, and creates a cusp. Okay. So let's look at this at the definition then, or the relationships that have to hold true in order to create that cusp there. And to do that, we're going to zoom in on this parent circular cylinder. We're going to put the center there. And so we've got our cylinder. And it is offset by, remember, this is called zeta naught, that location there. And it's got a y value, or an imaginary value, of eta naught. And it's got a real value of xi naught. Now, I should say that I'm not very good at writing xi's compared to eta's. I'm going to try to exaggerate the xi's and put a lot of wiggles in there compared to zeta, so you can tell the difference between the two. Okay, so this is the center of our cylinder, and every point on the surface of the cylinder is a distance r away. And this is the real axis and the imaginary axis there. Okay, now our singularities, remember the singularity caused by this epsilon here remains on the real axis. So we need to move this circular cylinder over to the point that that singularity lies on the edge of that cylinder. So let's just do some geometry here. We're going to call that the trailing edge in the zeta plane. So that's going to be zeta t. That's the trailing edge. So one thing we know about this trailing edge is that the real part of zeta t minus zeta naught, so that's this distance from here to here, would be equal to, now this is r right here, this is the radius of the cylinder. So using Pythagorean's theorem, the length here is eta naught, and so we know what the length here is. In fact, let's just write that in there. The length of that is the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. Okay, so the real part of zeta t minus zeta naught is equal to the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. Okay, another way, so we can also say then zeta t is equal to, that location there is equal to xi naught, the length here, plus the length here. So so it's xi naught plus the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. Okay, now this has to be equal to r minus epsilon in order for this to be a singularity. Remember, zeta, the singularity happens at zeta equals r minus epsilon plus or minus. Well, we're talking about the positive side here. So we're talking about the positive value there. So it's got to be equal to r minus epsilon. And so actually, this now gives us a relationship between epsilon, r, and xi and eta. So it gives us a relationship between this epsilon, the r, and the xi and the eta that must be satisfied in order for this singularity to fall on the edge of the cylinder here. So we can solve for epsilon. If we just rearrange that, what we get is that epsilon is equal to r minus xi naught minus the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. Okay, so this is a requirement for Joukowsky airfoil. Anytime epsilon is equal to this relationship here, that means that we will have a Joukowsky airfoil. Okay, that creates a cusp at the trailing edge. Okay, so a couple things, other things we might want to do is we might want to know where the trailing edge and the leading edge are in the Z plane. So we might want to actually know where that location is, the trailing edge and the leading edge in the z plane. So let's work through that. So let's say that so z trailing edge is equal to, and up here I should actually write down the transformation here. We know that the Joukowsky transformation is that z equals zeta plus r minus epsilon squared over zeta. Okay, that's the general or the Joukowsky transformation that we're applying. And so we can just plug in this trailing edge location in zeta into this equation here and find where the trailing edge is in z. So what we would get is that that is equal to zeta trailing edge plus r minus epsilon squared over zeta trailing edge. And we know what where the trailing edge is in terms of xi and eta. So we can actually swap out those values there. So that's equal to xi naught plus the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. And then plus, I've got r minus, and instead of epsilon, I'm actually going to use this value of epsilon here. So that's equal to r, and then I've got to carry that negative through plus. So we've got a plus c naught plus square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. And that whole quantity is squared, divided by, and I've got a zeta in the denominator, and that is c naught plus the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. Okay, so this is z trailing edge, and you can probably see that this simplifies down pretty nicely. So these r's are going to cancel, and then this term in the numerator is squared here, but one of those will cancel with one of these in the denominator, and it just so happens that that term that doesn't cancel then is equal to this. And so what we'll get is that zt is equal to 2 times xi naught plus the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared. So that is the location of the trailing edge in the z plane. Okay, so we know where that is. We can do the same thing for the leading edge. So the way I drew this circle makes the leading edge look like it goes through the origin over here. So let me try to round out that circle a little bit. So that's probably a little bit better. But anyway, the leading edge, we're going to say, is the point where that circle crosses the real axis. Okay, so this is our zeta of the leading edge. And we can go through the exact same process as we did here. First, we need to figure out where an expression for zeta at the leading edge in terms of xi and eta here. So let's see, xi naught is that length there, and then we would subtract off. See, if we were to draw a line from the center here, that radius is the same. And so if we were to subtract off xi naught from r squared minus eta naught squared, that would give us this distance from the origin over to this point. Okay, so we know that zeta at the leading edge is equal to xi naught minus r squared minus eta naught squared. And we could go through and plug this now into this transformation and get a z at the leading edge. And I'm not going to work through that math. I'll just write down what it is. So what we would get is that the z at the leading edge is equal to minus 2 times r squared minus eta naught squared plus xi naught squared over the square root of r squared minus eta naught squared minus xi naught. Okay, so this is z at the leading edge. And okay, so now we know where our trailing edge is, we know our leading edge is in the Z plane. And one final thing we can do is just define a chord. So we're gonna say that the chord of this airfoil is equal to Z trailing edge minus Z leading edge. Now these are all real numbers, and you can see that by just looking at what these expressions look like. These are all real numbers in here. We don't have any complex numbers in here. So these all lie on the x-axis, or on the real axis in the Z plane here as well. So that chord is ZT minus ZL, which if we work through the math, what we'll get is 4 times R squared minus eta naught squared over the square root of R squared minus eta naught squared minus C naught. Okay, so this is what we're going to call the chord of a Joukowsky airfoil. Okay, so we have now fully defined a Joukowsky airfoil geometrically. And just to recap, remember that the Joukowsky airfoil has these four parameters here: R, epsilon, C naught, and eta naught, or zeta naught, which has two terms in it. Anyway, those are 4 degrees of freedom, and they've got to be related in a certain way here. So epsilon has to be related to the other three in this way in order to force this singularity to fall on the surface of the cylinder. And when we do that, it creates a cusp, okay? It creates the sharp trailing edge there. And so we can then find out where that trailing edge is, zeta t. It will always be on the real axis because epsilon is a real number up here. And so we can find out where zeta t is and actually transform that to z of t. We can do the same thing with the leading edge up here, zeta l, and do the transformation to find out where that is in the Z plane, so in the actual plane of the airfoil instead of the cylinder. And then we could subtract the two to get the what we're going to call the chord of Joukowsky airfoil.